talk amongst the band about what our first song should be. Ain't No Smoggy Smoke on Rocky Top or something like that. We'll keep it to praising the Lord this morning. This comes from Psalm 66. It says, "Let the whole earth shout joyfully to God. Sing about the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awe-inspiring are your works." Let's worship the Lord this morning.
Come on, you thirsty. my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by every stone, Messiah still and all alone.
The name of the Lord our God. We need you to guide us and to direct our paths and make a way in our lives. We need you as our healer today, Father. You know, those that are struggling physically and those that have had surgery this week and just need a fresh touch of God. We ask, Lord, that you be with Deborah Taylor today and let her sense your presence and your nearness. We pray for Sherry Reynolds and you'll continue to lift her up and let her know that God is here and that you're answering prayer. We pray for others, Lord, that are struggling physically, that they might know your presence and know your nearness today. And then, Lord, and you know those that are struggling emotionally today that just need a fresh touch of God, that need a calm in the midst of the storm today. Oh, Lord, would you be to that one, the sense of calm in their lives. And then, Lord, for those that are struggling spiritually, would you help us to see Jesus high and lifted up? And would you let us know that God is near and that you're answering prayer. Remind us, Lord, how much you love us and how much you want to help us and guide us today. And so, Lord, in these few moments that we have together, speak to us. Draw us to yourself. Bring glory to your name. And Father, for what you'll do and for the way that you'll help us and for the way that you'll guide us and for the way that you'll lead your church and for the way that you'll direct our paths, we'll give you the praise. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated this morning, but I welcome every visitor that's here this morning, trusting God will minister to you all morning long. Let me just make these few announcements. This afternoon at some of you dress up and do a great job. I love it when those that are giving out the candy dress up. If you can't dress up, we'll need people to hand out candy. There's probably 200 kids that come through the church on a trail of treat night. And so it's a big crowd that comes through. We funnel them through the hallway. They follow a little trail through the hallway. Then they cut across the kitchen. Then they come out the other hallway. They get a Bible at the end. And then they go home, take pictures in the foyer of the church. There'll be a place to pick up to take pictures. But it's a great time in the life of the church and a great time for the kids. And Trail of Treats is just coming down the pipe. If you can't be here, then send candy, all right? Candy, it never goes to waste. So if I have extra candy, I save it for the treat baskets in Christmas. It's still good. And if I have extra candy in January, then Tina and I come over to the office and we fill our pockets and we're good to go for a little while. But the candy never goes to waste. And so bring in the candy. Even if you can't attend, bring it in. And if you can't afford the candy, if you'd like to be one of those people that give out the candy, we'll have candy for you to give out. But we'd like some 20 to 25 stations, maybe 30. I'm not sure how many we normally have. But we want to give give the kids a great time here in the church during Trail of Treats. And so that's coming down the pike as well. Let's do our very best as we worship the Lord and do the will of God. Now, I know you all are exhausted today. You've been up to about midnight last night. Some of you had a hard time driving home. And then some of you actually couldn't sleep. You're just too excited to sleep. So I have told people in the past that if they fall asleep during the service, that it's good, it's all right with me. They get something out of the service. I want you to get something out of the service. But I'm not sure if you're tired because of the UT game, that excuses you. But anyway, this morning, for a few moments, I want to talk to you about God's promises and about guidance. God's promises about guidance. This is my last sermon in the Next Step series. It's the last sermon. What will God's will be for my life? I think that's a legitimate question. I believe it for the serious believer, for the serious follower of Jesus Christ, that there should be this question in my life: what is God's will for my life? Or what does the future hold, or God's future hold for my life? Or can I find His will? And I would tell you that I don't think we should agonize over it. I think we should pray about it and commit ourselves to the Lordship of Jesus Christ and then allow God to work out His perfect will in our life. How do I know what God wants me to do? Am I stuck in this in my life? Am I ever going to get out of this rut that I'm in? Am I stuck forever here? How is God going to help me to move my life forward? How do I move my life forward? And so for a few moments this morning, I want us to read the Word of God out of Isaiah chapter 42, verse 16. Would you stand for the reading of God's Word? We'll just read the Scripture first, and we'll go through several portions of the text this morning. The Bible says, "I'll lead the blind by the way they do not know. In paths they do not know, I will guide them. I will make darkness into light before them, and rugged places into plains. These are the things I will do, and I will not leave them undone." Shall we pray? Father, in these few moments that we have together, would you speak to us from the Word of God in the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I will lead the blind. I will lead the blind in the way that they do not know. I love even that phrase, the very beginning phrase, that God will lead the blind, that God will, that those that are blinded by brokenness, and those that are blinded by tears, and those that are blinded by pain, that God will lead the blind. There are times in our life when we don't know which way to turn, to the left or to the right. We're overwhelmed by the circumstances of life or the problems of life. And Isaiah wrote, "I'll lead the blind by the way they do not know." Then he says, "In paths they do not know, I will guide them." That God will guide our lives in paths that we do not know. I don't know if you understand this or not, but when you get my age, you'll kind of get a little bit more figured out. But you know, we make plans for life, but rarely does life go like planned. Would you agree with that? Can I get an amen? We make plans for life, but rarely does life go like it's planned. And the Bible says, in paths they do not know, I will guide them. That in those times in our life, when life isn't going like we planned it to go, that God is guiding us, that God is directing us. I'll make darkness into light before them, and rugged places into plains. These are the things I will do, and I will not leave them undone. That indeed God will go before us. And the Bible says He'll remove the obstacles of our life. He'll remove the things in our paths that hinder us, and He'll make a way in our lives. God is able. I will lead the blind in a way that they do not know. In paths they do not know, I will guide them. I will make darkness into light before them, and rugged places into plains. These are the things I will do, and I'll not leave them undone. Let me go to another portion of Scripture when He says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you and watch over you. God leads us. I remember as a high schooler, I was praying for the Lord's will. And I remember going to Mr. Higgins and asked Mr. Higgins, why doesn't God show me? I really had no call to preach. I had no direction in my life. I didn't know, wasn't certain what God was wanting to do with my life. And I struggled over it. As a matter of fact, I agonized over it. I preached a sermon, a senior sermon, and the Lord helped me. And I got out of the sanctuary, came out of the back of the auditorium, the kind of auditorium. This little old lady, kind of arthritic fingers, kind of tried to put her finger in my face. But she said, one of these days the Lord will get it through your thick head, you're called to preach. But I've learned that people can't call others to preach or others to be missionaries. That is ultimately that the God does the calling, and that God provides the pathway. God makes a way in our life. I finished my senior year, and I asked God what He wanted me to do, and I felt peace to go to the Bible college. And so I began my career at the Bible college. I still didn't know what God wanted me to do in my life. And it was kind of the culture of the Bible college for people to say, what are you going to do with your life? Are you going to be a preacher? Are you going to be a missionary? Because are you going to be an educator? There was mainly the curriculum that they had on the campus. And so I was so bombarded with those questions and so frustrated with those questions, I just got bad answers. I finally said to them, well, God's called me to be a hobo and to minister to all the people on the trains. That's what I plan to do with my life. And they knew that I was in trouble, and they knew just to laugh. And then after that one got a little boring, I took up Mom Paul. I wasn't dating at the time. I pulled back to the Bible College to be the dean of women, and I know that God will guide me. Oh, that one did not fly at all. Kind of got me in trouble. As a matter of fact, don't do that. I didn't know what the Lord's will was, and I asked Mr. Higgins, why doesn't the Lord show me it? And he gave me some good advice and some good thought life. As a matter of fact, he said, it's because the Lord would trust you. Well, I'm grateful for that answer. It helped me at the time. In other words, God can trust you to live day by day by day by day, not knowing what the future holds. And I believe that's a good answer, that God can trust us to live a day at a time without knowing all the future that is before us. I think sometimes that when we know the future, if God were to show us the future, that we might balk at the plan of God. God speaks to Jonah, and Jonah tells Jonah to go to Nineveh, and Jonah boards his ship to go to Tarshish. Jonah's not interested in doing the will of God when he sees all that God has laid out for him. When he says that, when God begins to speak to him and say, that go to Nineveh, Jonah is disinterested when God shows him his plan. And so sometimes God doesn't show his entire plan because he can only give it to us a step at a time. I suspect sometimes God doesn't show us his plan because we get ahead of God. We want to do it overnight. After all, we're Western culture, and we want it fast food. We want everything quickly. We want it done tomorrow. Everything has to come in a 24 or 48-hour period. That's the way we're geared. That's the way Amazon works, and we are Amazonites. I mean, we want it done promise of God into their own hands. And he says, Sarah says to Abraham, go to thy handmaid and have a child. And you know the rest of that story. Sometimes God can't trust us with all of our future and can't answer all of our questions because he knows we would get ahead of God. The Bible says, I'll instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I'll counsel you and watch over you. God rarely maps out our whole life before us. It's been my experience that life comes in increments, that life happens in moments. When there are these times in our lives when there's this aha moment that the divine has spoken to the natural, to man, and there's this sense that, yes, God is up to something, and God is moving in my life, and God is directing me to the next step. We think we would love for God to map it all out and show us all at the same time, but rarely does God do that. The Bible says the path of the righteous is like the first gleam of dawn shining ever brighter to the full light of day. A few years ago, I went to Fairbanks, Alaska. My brother was working on a house, and so all the brothers, all the siblings, I think there was all of us but one, five of us went to Fairbanks, Alaska to help him to build an addition onto his house. My family are kind of tradesmen. My one brother's an electrician. The other brother's worked for construction companies. I've done a little fair amount of construction in my life, and my sister was there. We all worked for 2 weeks. But I'll never forget Alaska. It was in July. In Alaska, at midnight, it was still light outside. Now there was no sunshine outside, but it was light outside. I pulled the blinds. I stayed in the basement. It was difficult to get asleep until about the third day when you were so tired you couldn't stay awake that you finally fell asleep in the evening in the light. But I got up about 4 o'clock in the morning to catch my flight, and it was still light outside. I don't think it really ever did get dark. It just got dusty. But we came down the mountain where my brother lived, looked over to the left, and the sun was just coming over the horizon, 4 o'clock in the morning. And this beam, just a little beam of light. And that beam of light, I remember looking at it thinking to myself, it's so bright. It's so clear. It's so present. And then I thought to myself, and now everything is bright. The mountains of Fairbanks, Alaska, and the surrounding area became beautiful as the sun shone its light upon the earth. And then I read the scripture, the path of the righteous is like the first gleam of dawn, shining ever brighter until the full light of day. That is, that God shows us in a little increments, little moments in our life, like a beam of light coming over the mountains in Fairbanks, Alaska. And he shows us something that stirs our heart, that gives us promise, that gives us a sense that God is at work. And then it isn't long until God opens the heaven and we see it all and we see what God is doing in our lives. Sometimes I pray this prayer, oh God, just give me the cloud the size of the hand. You remember when Elijah prayed, and he was praying for rain, and he needed the promise of God. He was getting weary of drought, and he said, oh God, just give me something. And he prayed, and God gave him the cloud the size of a hand. God leads us in increments, but I can tell you that the path of the righteous is like the first gleam of the dawn, shining ever brighter to the full light of day. Listen to what he says in Psalms chapter 77, verse 19. Your road led through the Red Sea, your pathway through the mighty waters, a pathway no one knew was there. Are you listening to the scripture? Are you reading it? The road led through the Red Sea. Well, we would like God to help us to maneuver around the obstacles of life, wouldn't we? But sometimes God sends us right through the obstacles. Sometimes we have to face them. And sometimes God lets Some of them will be difficult, and some of them will be absolutely wonderful. There'll come a time in your life when you'll look back in the rearview mirror and you'll say, Jesus led me all the way. Step by step, he led each day. I'll tell the saints and angels as I lay my burden down that Jesus led me all the way. God promises guidance for my life. So how does he guide me? He guides me, number one, he guides me by his Spirit. He guides me by his Spirit. Listen to what he says in Psalms chapter 143, verse 10. He said, teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your good Spirit lead me on level ground. It's the Holy Spirit of God that leads us. He says in John chapter 16, when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he'll guide you into all truth. He will bring glory to me by taking from what is mine and making it known to you. It's the Spirit of God that leads us. I would say that the Spirit of God opens our minds. I wouldn't say to this crowd that's in the auditorium this morning, but I would say to those that are perhaps listening on the internet, but sometimes even the church or the people of God can be a little obstinate in their thinking. Would you agree? Sometimes our thinking is very narrow. You remember last Sunday, I preached about not being conformed to this world, but being transformed by the renewing of your mind. That oftentimes we're conformed to the way we were raised, or the way that we were taught, or the feelings that we have. We're conformed to all those things in our lives. But it's the Holy Spirit that opens and broadens our thinking, our minds, and allows us to see the path of God, allows us to see the work of God in our lives. It's the Holy Spirit of God that guides us. He moves us out of our narrow-mindedness. He moves us beyond our obstinance, and he opens our minds to what perhaps God is doing in my life. Listen to what he says in the Word of God. No one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. We have received the Spirit who is from God, that we may understand what God has freely given us. The man without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them, because they are spiritually discerned. But we have the mind of Christ. Some of what God will speak to you about, some of what God will open your mind to, will be foolishness to the world, will be ridiculousness to the world. They won't understand why you're doing what you're doing. But ultimately, when we're Spirit-led, God begins to help his church and the people of God to see things like we've not seen them before. There have been many times in my life when God has helped me to see things differently, to view things differently, to expose me to things that were different. Several years ago, the Church of Nazarene had a little program called the K-Church Program. Part of what they wanted us to do is expose us to other churches, and so they sent us to Florida for a conference, which was pretty nice, to be honest with you. And then they sent us to California, to San Diego, and we were on the bay there. And they at the time, the church was going through that whole change of music, which was pretty contentious, if you remember it. If you look back, it could be just a little overwhelming. And when he got into those other churches and you saw people worship and you felt the Spirit of God, you began to see that God works in all kinds of different venues. That God uses all kinds of different ministries. That my world was, third person of the triune God, unless he speaks to you, unless he opens your heart, unless he opens your mind, we have received the Spirit who is from God, that we may understand what God has freely given us. And God has freely given us direction. God has freely given us guidance for our lives. The man without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. I just want to pause here just for a second, and I know I've got a lot to do here. But periodically, I just have to tell you, well, even Dean and I were talking about it this week. We love the church. You all have been so good to us. And we just think you, I don't know, we just think you're hung the moon. I don't know any other way to express it, but we were just talking about it this week. And while we were talking about it, I was reminded of the body of Christ and the work of God in our lives that helps transform the people of God. And in our conversation, I just expressed this, that in our own lives and in the lives of the church, there's plenty of chaos. Let's just confess it. There's a fair amount of problems. But it's not like the chaos of the world. I mean, if you look outside the church, there's nothing to go to. There's nothing to run to. There's nothing. It's chaos. The church, led by the Spirit of God, Spirit-filled Christians understand that the mind of Christ, for they are the things of God, and the things are foolishness to them that don't know him. And he cannot understand them because they are spiritually discerned. But we have the mind of Christ, the Holy Spirit of God. Will Satan all? How does God guide me? He guides me by his Spirit. He guides me by his word. He guides me by his word. It's the word of God speaks to me. The Bible says your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light for my path. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. The Bible is not a map. It's more of a compass. I want you to think about it for a minute. I don't even think the younger generation know how to use a map. I don't know if they've ever experienced an atlas before. I think we'll have to hand out atlases so they can experience an atlas and know the difference between four-lane highways and two-lane highways. And we ought to do better with our GPSs, all right? The gospel is not a map. It's a compass. It guides our life. It keeps us pointed in the right direction. It helps us when we go to the left or go to the right. It helps us when we stray. It helps us when we miss the mark. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. It's a compass to my thoughts. It redirects my thoughts to the places that where my thoughts should be in my life. The word of God redirects and directs me my thoughts into his word, into what God wants me to think about. It's a compass that helps me in the ideas of my life. He begins to lead my life and direct my life. It's a compass that helps me with the ideas of my life and my thinking process. It's a compass that helps me to overcome my fears. If it wasn't for the word of God, I would be very fretful and very fearful. But periodically, when I feel myself ramping up, I go to the word of God and I listen to the word of God and I hear him say, "Fret not thyself." And I hear it over and over and over again. And I think to myself that God is with me. And I look over my past and I say, "Well, God, help me here. And God, help me here. And God, help me here." Just like David and Goliath. God helped David with the bear. God helped David with the lion. And now God will help with this Goliath. That I have this history with God. That God will lead me. And all of a sudden, I find that all Scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. The Holy Spirit, the work of God in our lives, never deviates from the Scripture. All over the years in life, I've had people that come to me and they've kind of, I think they've been their own little lawyers. They've made a case for themselves. They've made a case to justify what they want to do and how they want to do it and all that kind of stuff. And the basic answer is, what does the Scripture say? That's the guiding force. That's the compass. That's the way you come to be. If it's not scriptural, then don't do it. And if it's scriptural, let the Holy Spirit lead. But the Spirit of God will never contradict the Holy Scripture. Let's say so. He guides me by his people. Listen to what he says. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another. He guides me by his people. It's the church that helps us in our journey of faith. It's the church that helps us guide us for life. I want to just kind of point this out just for a moment. In the Church of the Nazarene, our history begins in Los Angeles and in inner city missions among the poor. The church was really ministered, began in poverty among the poor. And in White Pilot, Texas was the same. Most of our roots were with the poor. But it's the Church of Jesus Christ that keeps pushing us upward. It's the body of Christ that keeps pushing us upward. It's the body of Christ that introduced education. So in the Church of the Nazarene, we have universities all over the country because the church believed in education. They believed that the church, the people of God, that God had his hand upon them, and that they could find their niche in life, they could find their calling in life, they could find their purpose in life, and that God would help them in the midst of their education. It was the church that helped in building hospitals. It was the church that got involved in healthcare. Look around our own county and look at the hospitals that began, like Methodist Hospital, through the church. Most Catholic charities, most Catholic hospitals began in the church. It's always been the church and his people that have blessed the world. Church of Nazarene began at humble beginnings, but now we're about three generations away from where we began, and the church has really become a suburban church. Now, I think that's a good thing for the most part, but I do think that we can't forget the poor. Does that make sense? I think it is our obligation, it is scriptural. But I will tell you that is, he guides me by his people. It's the church that's the support system. It's the church that's been the educator. It's the church where we find a place to serve. Yesterday we were getting ready for Fun Day Sunday. There were four guys came here and we're working on it, getting chairs out, tables out, and the pavilion, and the arena's been getting all. Well, listen, if you don't have a place to serve, how can you serve God? After all, Jesus said, as much as you've done unto the least of these, my brother, you did it to me. It's my name that convicts me, Mother Teresa said. You did it to me. Every person should find a place to serve and someone to serve. It shouldn't be one or two people that are taking meals. It should be the body of Christ. It shouldn't be the people of God. It's the church that gives us opportunity. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another. Listen to what he says in Proverbs chapter 27, verse 17. As iron sharpens iron, so a friend sharpens a friend. It's the church, the people of God, that connect with each other and sharpen each other. I've heard Ernie talk about being an engineer. can't tell you how many times I've heard him talk to young people in the foyer of the church about becoming an engineer. I thought to myself, what a place to hear about engineering right here at the New Life Church of the Nazarene. I just believe that that's how it works, that the body of Christ sharpens each other, that God helps us on our journey, and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Help us, it is a church that encourages us, that spurs us on, that helps us to do the will of God. It's a church that helps us to know what the will of God is, and then helps us to accomplish the will of God in our lives and for our lives. He guides me by his people. I've thought about it many times. So many opportunities in my life came because of the church. I suspect if we took a moment, I won't do it this morning, and we had people raise their hand and tell how many countries they've been in on work and witness trips and other things, you'd be flabbergasted. That opportunity comes through the church. Some would have never experienced it. It's the church that broadens us. He guides me through his people. He guides me by his circumstances. The Bible says we know that all things God works for the good of those that love him, who have been called according to his purpose. That God guides us through the circumstances of our life. They may not always be pleasant, but it's God guiding us. It's God directing us. It's God making a way in our lives. It's God doing his perfect will. He guides us through the circumstances of our life. There have been multiple times in my life when I look back and said, God was pushing me here because this happened. My father-in-law used to say about pastors, I hope I'm not changing churches. I don't plan to change churches. I just wanted to set the record here. Anyway. Nobody said amen. That's a good sign. My father-in-law said sometimes God stirs the nest in order for us to get out. Have you ever heard that before? And sometimes in our lives, there are adverse circumstances that are pushing us a different direction. And it's not to be seen in bitterness or anguish or fear. It's to be seen as God working out his perfect will in our lives. That he's guiding us toward the next step. That he's leading us toward the next step. That he's about to reveal something fresh and something new in our life. He guides me by circumstances. And finally this morning, he guides me by his still small voice. His still small voice. That inner voice. Some of you will call it a gut feeling. I'm okay with that. Some of you, my mother used to call it a sixth sense. I'm okay with that. Just as long as you understand where it comes from. But ultimately, it's the Holy Spirit. Elijah went out into a cave and spent the night. And suddenly the Lord spoke to him, Elijah, what are you doing here? He answered, Lord, God Almighty, I've always served you, you alone. But the people of Israel have broken their covenant with you, torn down their altars, and killed all your prophets. I am the only one left. And they are trying to kill me. Go out and stand before me on the mountain, the Lord said to him. Then the Lord passed by and sent a furious wind that split the hills and shattered the rocks. But the Lord was not in the wind. The wind stopped blowing, and then there was an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquakes, there was fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, there was a soft whisper. The soft whisper of the Holy Spirit. Then Elijah heard it. He covered his face with his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. A voice said to him, Elijah, what are you doing here? It's that still, gentle whisper of the Holy Spirit that speaks to us. Sometimes it doesn't thunder and lightning like we would. church. Still felt no call to preach, but I knew I was in the center of God's will. I felt wonderful peace to be working there with M.K. Weaver, and I felt like God taught me so much through that church and through Pastor Weaver's ministry. About the last year, that fifth year, I began to feel urgency to preach the gospel. Nobody had their finger in my face. Nobody had to tell me. It was just that sense of peace, sense of God, that work of God. And I said, all right, it's time. I'll do whatever you ask me to do. I committed to that a long time ago. I committed to do whatever God asked me to do. I interviewed a couple places. They were not the right place. Then I got a little call from the Franklin Church of the Nazarene, right outside of Indianapolis. I knew before I ever left, it was God's will. You can have such a security and such a sense of peace. You can so surrender your fears, and so surrender the obstacles. You can so surrender all those things to the Lordship of Jesus Christ that you'll know. You'll just know. God's in it. And He's going to make a way. Is it always easy? It's a compass, not a map. It's following His still small voice, His direction. It's listening to His Holy Spirit. Would you stand with me this morning? I just want us to sing maybe a verse of song this morning. I don't know if we can put that together just for a second. But I wonder if God is speaking to us this morning. If God is leading us this morning. If God is directing us. With every head bowed and every eye closed, would there be some that would say, Pastor, I'm seeking God for the next step. By lifting a hand, I see the hand in the back. You just say, Lord, I'm seeking the next step. All over the back, my right, my left, all over this auditorium are men and women that are seeking God. I can tell you this. I've expressed it to my wife multiple times. If I die today, I'll have looked back and said I've had a wonderful life. I'm grateful for the opportunities and the grace of God and for the way the Lord has led. I wouldn't trade a moment because He's faithful. We're going to pray and then we're going to sing. And if you would like to come around these altars and pray, we'd close, love to close in prayer with you. Just say, Lord, I need You. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, all you weary and thirsty. I need You. Father, today, direction in our lives, and we're seeking you, Lord. We're seeking you first and foremost in our lives. We're asking you to guide us. We're asking you to direct our paths, Lord. You know the unknown. Nothing's hidden from you today. You know our past, and you know our present, and you know our future. And now, Lord, Holy Spirit of God, would you just guide us? Would you just direct us? Would you just open our hearts and our minds to your Holy Spirit? Would your word come alive as we read it? And would you direct our paths and let us know that God is at work in our lives? And for that one, Lord, that struggles today, just a concern about what is the next step, oh Lord, just bring unusual peace. Just bring a sense of your presence. Just bring a sense of calm, knowing that God is going to work it out, knowing that you're going to direct our paths, knowing, Lord, that you're already ahead of us today. Oh, Lord, we may feel cornered. We may be at the sea in front of us, and the Egyptians behind us, and the mountains on the side of us, but, Lord, you're going to go before us. You can part the waters. You can reveal yourself and reveal your glory. And so, Father, this morning, right here around these altars in this auditorium, and those who are listening today, Father, help us just to seek you first and foremost. Help us to call upon you. Help us to trust you. Help us to believe you. Help us, Lord, to know that God is with us this morning. Lord, you said in your word, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. You said in your word, but my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. You said, Lord, he that cometh unto me, I'll in no wise cast out. And Father, this morning we've come to you. We've asked you. We're seeking you. And asking you, the Holy Spirit of God, to direct our paths. Minister to us all afternoon long. Make us conscious of the presence and the power of God. Lord, open our minds to thinking that we haven't thought about before. Open our hearts to your Holy Spirit and help the Word of God to be revealed in life today. And Father, for the way that you'll help us, for the way that you reveal yourself, for the way that you bring glory to your name, we'll give you the praise. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. And amen. I just believe this. You can just count on it. We're insincere about wanting to know the Lord's will. You'll know. I just believe if our heart is surrendered, and when we've got ourselves out of the way, then God can have his perfect way. And so those that are seeking, you should rest assured that God's going to make a way. That God's going to reveal himself and reveal his glory, reveal his power, reveal his might. Because that's who he is. He works in our lives. I want you to shake hands with about 15 people. Oh, maybe fist bump. I'm not sure where we're at on all that. Consider yourself dismissed. Come back tonight at 4 o'clock. Don't worry if you didn't make ice cream. There's going to be plenty of ice cream. Come bring it to the children. Bring your friends and your neighbors. We'll have a great time.